By the mid-1930s, Brooklands had become equal parts motor racing circuit and high-tech business park. Attracted by the promise of the right crowd and no crowding, hordes of spectators regularly watched the likes of Malcolm Campbell, George Easton, and John Cobb racing on the Great Banked Oval, whilst many aircraft manufacturers and motor racing specialists were based on the circuit's infield. John Cobb had already set several track records at Brooklands before he commissioned engineering firm Thompson & Taylor to build him an aero-engined monster. In 1935, Cobb showed extraordinary courage at the wheel of the 23.9-litre Napier Railton when he lapped Brooklands at an average speed of 143.44 miles per hour, the uneven concrete banking leaving the car airborne. Following in the footsteps of Campbell and Easton, Cobb now set his sights on the land speed record, and once again he would look to the creator of his Brooklands record breaker to design his new car. Reid Railton had become a different sort of legend at Brooklands. One-time assistant to record breaker John Parry Thomas, Railton had risen to become chief designer at Brooklands-based engineering firm Thompson & Taylor. His designs included record-breaking cars for Malcolm Campbell, as well as the chassis for the highly successful ERA racers and John Cobb's stunning Napier-powered Brooklands record holder. When Cobb commissioned him to design a new land speed challenger, the result was radical, innovative, and widely acknowledged as a work of genius. Over the car's lifetime, Railton's creation had many names, but land speed history knows it as the Railton Mobil Special. By 1935, Reid Railton had already overseen the evolution of the Bluebird land speed car for Malcolm Campbell, another Brooklands regular. Campbell had taken the record at 301 miles per hour in the Campbell Railton Bluebird using a 36-litre V12 Rolls-Royce aero engine, which developed 2,800 horsepower. For Cobb's new car, given the secret designation Q5000, Railton would take a fresh approach. First and foremost, aerodynamics would dictate the layout and shape of the car. Weight and size would be kept to a minimum. At Brooklands, Railton looked to leading auto and aero engineering companies who'd shared the site for their advice. He was able to discuss the project with the likes of John Irving, who designed Henry Seagrave's Golden Arrow, Vickers Aircraft chief designer Rex Pearson, and R.J. Mitchell, designer of the trophy-winning Supermarine seaplane and future creator of the Spitfire. Extensive wind tunnel testing of several suggested designs led Railton to choose a sleek teardrop shape for the new car. Cobb and Railton's previous collaboration, the Railton Napier Special, had used the 23.9-litre Napier Lion aero engine to great effect. The Lion engine already had an illustrious record in both air racing and land speed record breaking, and the engine's compact design, with cylinders arranged in three banks of four, made it a good match for Railton's design philosophy. However, with Cobb's ambitions fixed on 400 miles per hour, not even the 1,300 horsepower produced by the Lion's latest supercharged variant would be enough. Cobb had been gifted a pair of supercharged Lions by eccentric oil heiress Marion Carstairs, who'd been using them in one of her racing powerboats. Whilst using two engines would provide the required power, it would also present a multitude of problems with packaging, cooling, and transmission. Overcoming these obstacles would showcase Railton's true genius. As work on the new car began, George Easton was completing his own challenger, Thunderbolt, in secret. Easton's two-engine design, whilst impressive in its engineering, had fallen victim to a vicious circle of constraints and solutions that led to it finally weighing in at over 7 tons. The extreme power from the twin Rolls-Royce engines required a huge gearbox to combine their output and drive the wheels. The gearbox alone ended up weighing over a ton. To provide adequate traction and spread the car's weight so the tyre loading would remain within safe limits, Easton's car had 3 axles and 8 wheels, adding yet more weight. The brute force of Thunderbolt's engines provided the power to overcome what might otherwise have become an unworkable arrangement, but Railton, designing Cobb's new car before Thunderbolt was unveiled, sought a different solution. Railton had already decided that four-wheel drive would be necessary to avoid using double wheels for traction, as Easton had done with Thunderbolt. On the face of it, This would need a complex gear train. However, by turning one engine through 180 degrees to drive the front wheels, a heavy transfer box and differential would not be necessary, and the contra-rotating engines would help with stability. By angling the engines inwards and using a chassis which described an S-shape rather than a conventional straight frame, Railton's ingenious design was simpler, lighter, and far more compact than Easton's. As Cobb's new car was secretly assembled at Thompson & Taylor's Brooklands workshop, the company's engineers gradually learned the details of Railton's extraordinary design. The unique dogleg chassis was built by John Thompson Motor Pressings, who were also responsible for Henry Seagrave's Mystery and Golden Arrow record breakers. Railton's chassis design included holes in the top and bottom surfaces to allow the inboard exhaust from the Napier engines to pass through and vent under the car. With engines and other mechanicals filling the space between the axles, extensions were added to the front and rear of the car to provide mounting points for the streamlined body. The extended front section also contained the cockpit. Cobb would sit at the very front of the car, amongst slimline pressings and minimal bulkheads. In the event of an accident at speed, Railton's lightweight design would offer little protection to the driver. The sleek body was fabricated from Alclad, a bonded aluminium sheet which had previously been used in aircraft and airship construction. The same craftsman who built bodies for Brooklands racing cars used traditional panel beating and wheeling techniques to create the futuristic teardrop shape. Conceived as a single structure, once the panels were welded together, the body could be removed in one piece to get access for maintenance. The car's low profile meant that blisters had to be formed into the skin to accommodate the wheels, whilst a conning tower enclosed the cockpit and provided a tiny windscreen for Cobb to peer through. Railton's choice of iced water to provide cooling to the engines and brakes meant there were no cooling ducts or radiator intakes to compromise the body's smooth lines. When completed in the spring of 1938, the Railton Special measured 28 feet long, 8 feet wide, and 4 feet 3 inches high. At 2.8 tons, it was less than half the weight of Easton's Thunderbolt, which had raised the record to 311 miles per hour in late 1937. Invited to view Railton's new creation on April 5, 1938, the press were generous in their praise for the design and engineering innovation on display. A 21st century car. The cleverest thing on wheels that has yet been seen. An engineering masterpiece. Cobb's peers in land speed record breaking, Sir Malcolm Campbell and Captain George Easton, were similarly impressed. Campbell called it astonishing, a wonder car, whilst current record holder Easton admired its sheer engineering wizardry. Railton's minimal lightweight design was clearly the polar opposite of the approach Easton had taken in creating Thunderbolt. The scene was now set for an epic showdown between the two friends. Later in 1938, Cobb and Easton would take their radically different machines to Bonneville and compete head-to-head for land speed glory. Cobb and his team headed for Bonneville at the end of July 1938. George Easton had begun preparations to improve on his own record at the Salt Flats weeks earlier, but poor weather and flooding had delayed any chance of a record attempt. As soon as conditions allowed, Easton began testing Thunderbolt, while Cobb made his own preparations. With his car untested before it left Britain, Cobb's initial shakedown run without the body fitted saw him run at almost 250 miles per hour. First runs with the body on caused the aluminium skin to deform at the rear due to air pressure, and heat from the exhaust also damaged the bodywork. With reinforcing pieces and heat shields fitted, Cobb ran the car up to a 300 miles per hour peak on August the 20th. With an average speed through the mile of 270 miles per hour, Cobb felt that the record was within reach. Easton made his own record attempt on August the 25th, but issues with the timing beams meant the time went unrecorded. Consequently, both Thunderbolt and the Railton were partially painted black to improve contrast before further attempts were made. Thunderbolt was clearly faster than it had been the previous year, and on August the 27th, Easton added more than 30 miles per hour to the record to set a new mark of 345.21 miles per hour. Now it would be Cobb's turn to show what the Railton Special could do. Early on September the 15th, less than 3 weeks after Easton had set his new record, Cobb's car was push-started by the support truck and raced off across the Sault. After a run north at an average of 353.29 miles per hour, with new tyres, fuel and coolant aboard, Cobb returned south to set a new land speed record of 350.2 miles per hour. Meanwhile, Easton had modified Thunderbolt, possibly taking some cues from the Railton's design. The huge car's tail fin was removed to reduce drag, and the nose was given a new rounded profile. The day after Cobb set his record, Easton took his reshaped car to a new record of 357.5 miles per hour. As the 1938 season ended and the teams returned home, Easton remained the fastest man on earth, but he knew that Thunderbolt had reached the very limit of its capabilities. Railton, on the other hand, had plans to improve Cobb's car for a return to Bonneville in 1939. Cobb's team returned to Bonneville in mid-August 1939, with sponsor Gilmore Oil Company's Red Lion logo displayed prominently on the car, which was, at this point, sometimes referred to as the Railton Red Lion. Railton had drawn on the team's experiences the previous year, and changes were made to the car's frame and suspension, in addition to extensive revisions to the cooling system. The drive to the engine superchargers was improved to increase boost, and a small air duct was added to the front of the car to increase airflow to the engines. Early on August the 23rd, 1939, Cobb and his car were ready for an attempt on the record. On the first run north across the Sault, Cobb averaged 370.75 miles per hour, and 25 minutes later, the car was refueled and ready to return south. The average of the two runs was a new land speed record of 369.74 miles per hour through the mile, with a peak speed of 380 miles per hour. As Cobb and his team celebrated their success and headed home, the weather broke and flooded the Sault Flats. Railton still anticipated returning to Bonneville with the car one day, saying, "Someday it will go even faster. It all depends on what Mr. Hitler decides to do." By the time Cobb reached England on the passenger liner Aquitania, Europe was already at war. From Utah, the Railton Special was sent north to Canada, before returning to Britain by the end of 1939. At Thompson and Taylor's workshop, the engines were removed and stored before the car was moved to Horsell, a small village just 7 miles from Brooklands, but considered to be much less at risk from German bombs than the aircraft factories now built at the famous circuit. The Railton Special spent the rest of the war hidden in a barn, alongside Cobb's Napier Railton Racer. As the war progressed, Cobb served as a pilot in the RAF and the Air Transport Auxiliary, and appeared uncredited in the British wartime propaganda film Target for Tonight. Meanwhile, Reid Railton settled in California to take up a position with the Hall Scott Motor Company, developing large marine engines which were widely used during the war. When the war ended in 1945, the Railton Special was returned to Thompson and Taylor at Brooklands to be recommissioned and modified. Increased boost from the superchargers and higher octane fuel from new sponsor Mobil raised the total power from the two engines to 3,300 horsepower. But the biggest changes were those made to the car's transmission. To save weight, Railton had removed the engine's flywheels, but this had caused issues with stalling during gear changes. Railton cured this by adding an extra clutch and drive shaft to each gearbox, preventing the engine revs from dropping below 1/7 of the output shaft speed. The newly named Railton Mobil Special was shown to the press in June 1947, before departing for Bonneville the following month.
"This car broke the land speed record with a speed of 369 miles an hour in August 1939, and having overhauled it, I'm taking it out again to America
Poor track conditions and mechanical issues caused the team lengthy delays, but by September the 16th, as the wind across the salt flats picked up, both Cobb and the car were ready. Heading south, Cobb clocked 385.645 miles per hour through the measured mile. Once the car was turned around and refueled, the Railton returned even faster. Still accelerating as it left the measured mile, Cobb's car averaged 403.136 miles per hour for a new world land speed record of 394.196 miles per hour. Confident that they could raise the two-way record to over 400 miles per hour, the team made plans to run again the next day, but heavy rain flooded the course and put paid to any further running. Despite this, in late 1947, Cobb held the world record and could also claim to be the first to drive a car at over 400 miles per hour. As it struggled with the aftershocks of the Second World War, the world in 1947 had little interest in challenging Cobb's record. With his own finances impacted by high post-war taxation, Cobb decided not to campaign the Railton again until his record was broken. Like fellow Brooklands racers Henry Seagrave and Malcolm Campbell before him, John Cobb now took aim at the world water speed record. Cobb again looked to his friend Railton, who proposed building a hydroplane powered by a turbojet, and the result was Crusader, built at Vospers by Peter Duquesne. In September 1952, backed by a support team including his friend and land speed rival George Easton, John Cobb took to the waters of Loch Ness. Watching these early trials from the shore was a six-year-old Richard Noble, who was inspired to pursue his own career as a record breaker. On September the 29th, 1952, whilst travelling across the loch at an estimated 240 miles per hour, Crusader hit a series of waves that led to a porpoising and nosediving under the water. As his craft disintegrated, John Cobb was thrown clear, but tragically sustained fatal injuries. Hundreds of mourners attended the funeral near his home in Surrey. A memorial to Cobb now stands on the shores of Loch Ness. Railton was deeply affected by Cobb's death. In hindsight, he felt that Crusader as built did not fully represent his intended design, as his involvement had been limited by commitments in the US. Footage of the crash was studied and suggested a number of areas where the design could be improved in future craft, some of which were incorporated into Donald Campbell's Bluebird K7. Meanwhile, aided by George Easton, Railton designed a new world water speed hydroplane, which sought to develop ideas and lessons learned from Crusader. Sadly, the project never saw the light of day and was quietly shelved. Reid Railton, engineer and innovator, died in Berkeley, California in 1977, aged 82. Fittingly, Railton's ashes were scattered in the north of the state, on Cobb Mountain. After John Cobb's death, the Railton Mobil Special was sold to the Dunlop Rubber Company. As the world's fastest car, it was exhibited in the US and Europe, and finally presented to Birmingham museums. The car is now on display at Think Tank, the Birmingham Science Museum. Despite Mickey Thompson's single run at over 400 miles per hour in 1960, John Cobb's 1947 two-way record stood until it was broken in 1964 by Donald Campbell in Bluebird CN7, although Craig Breedlove and Spirit of America were later awarded the record, backdated to 1963. For 25 years, the Railton Mobil Special was officially the fastest car on Earth. Today, it remains a monument to both John Cobb's vision and Reid Railton's genius. If you've enjoyed this video, please subscribe and check out Scarf and Goggles for more tales of record breaking. Until next time.